giving birth to gods and monsters. Tonight, I am kind of awed that this many people would come out to talk about two texts you've probably never heard of, but credit to you. Well done. Let's trace just a little bit where we've come from. We discussed in the first lecture how to make a god, and we discussed Stuart Guthrie's theory that religion is anthropomorphism, that the religious process is seeing ourselves writ large in the world and ascribing to that projection the qualities of deity. And that's because, according to some cognitive scientists, we have these kind of God-shaped mental constructs from birth that, I shouldn't say they're God-shaped. They are shaped where God will fit and does fit sometimes. They're shaped for all kinds of things. They're shaped for animism and anthropomorphism especially. And so, in those terms, we make God in our image. Last week was a lot of fun for me. I hope it was for you. We got to talk about Freud and monster culture. And basically that there is a monster within, just as there is a God within. And that Freud called that monster the id. We can call it other things, but it's basically the pleasure principle, that part of us that craves and craves and craves and doesn't really care about any consequences, even if we don't get what we crave. We'll just keep craving. And then, of course, we saw that monsters represent our greatest fears. And again, it's that same process, of taking something that's internal, projecting it, and enhancing it, and then reading it back, right? And that's monsters. And we also talked about monsters and their relationship to the other. Well, these two texts tonight are unique in the world in that they describe the birth of gods and monsters. They really do. That's Hesiod's Theogony and the Mesopotamian story Enuma, Elish. So let me just walk you through these stories, and I think you'll find them pretty weird and wonderful. And then we'll draw some conclusions about what they mean to us today. So the Theogony is it's a compound word in Greek, theos, gonia, the birth of the gods, quite literally, or the genealogy of the gods. This is Hesiod, who's a really interesting character. He lived at the same time as Homer, but he was kind of like Homer's poor cousin or something. I mean, he was just, and he says this about himself. He says, I'm not an eloquent man. I'm just a farmer. Beware of people who say, I'm just a farmer. I think of Wendell Berry, if you know him. That is one smart farmer that will trip you up if you're not careful. He seems like that. And in fact, he has another work, another book called Works and Days, which is in part a large complaint against his brother. but he works in the gods, right? And I think we can relate to that, how you can work in the gods when you're pissed at somebody. He does that. Hesiod's genius here, in part, is his opening paragraph in the Theogony, which is, it was the muses who taught me Hesiod, their beautiful song. Nice rhetorical move, right? So it's not me speaking, I'm just a farmer. It's the muses, the great muses who inspire everyone, that's who's speaking. So the Theogony, it's linked on the site. I don't know if you read it. It's pretty rough going. The public domain translations are a little difficult, but if you dig through it, it's pretty interesting. It is about the birth of the gods. And the first god is chaos. The first god is chaos. I think that speaks volumes right there. And what happens is chaos, from chaos emerges Gaia. These are their names, Tartarus, Eros, Erebus, Nyx, Aether, and Hemera. Alright, so these are the gods. Except they're not just gods. This is the creation story of the world through, not through gods, as gods. And this is actually something that we see not only in the Enuma Elish, but in other creation stories around the world, is that the emergence of the cosmos is the emergence of the gods. It's the same thing. In the Theogony, it's literally the same thing. So you see that in this sense, if we look at what the concept, what the god names refer to, what happened is there was emptiness. And then there was earth. And earth brought forth the pit. Okay, again, not a bedtime story here. Then lust. Okay. Darkness, then night. Upper air, that is the air for the gods. And then day. This is starting to sound a little familiar, just some resonance with another creation story. It should. So here, let me give you just a little Hesiod's framing of this, his words. First it was emptiness, and next, broad-bosomed earth. Right? I love that, because remember, we're dealing in an oral culture here, so there's never just going to be a simple thing. There's always going to be a cluster of adjectives around it. First was emptiness, and next broad-bosomed earth, ever-secure seat of all the immortals who inhabit the peaks of snow-capped Olympus and dark, dim pit in a recess of the earth, having broad ways and lust, who is most beautiful among the immortal gods, lust that relaxes the limbs and in the breasts of all god and men, subdues their reason and prudent counsel. But from emptiness were born darkness and black night, and from night again sprang forth air and day, whom she bore after having conceived by union with darkness in love. Okay. So, you can see already what's happening here. This is a kind of stew. A mixture of chaos, or at least emptiness, material, some sort of material, the earth, and then there's a principle, there's an energy. Freud would call it libido, but it's the procreative urge, right? That gets its own god, because you can't just have things. Right? You have to have some sort of energy to animate them. And that here is lust. Or, yeah, let's just call it lust. All right. So, then what happens? Okay, we've got this interesting, basically unformed world with some personalities in it and a principle of procreation in it. What happens next? Gaia, or the earth, and sky, or Uranus, the sky comes down and lays on the earth. And the principle of lust is involved. And so Gaia now begets children, not parthenogenically, not just of herself, but as a product of a union. Okay, we're going to have sex in here at some point, right? Procreation that we recognize. So she becomes pregnant. Uranus, sky, and remember, sky gods are almost always male, except in Egypt. Uranus is not happy that Gaia is pregnant, and pushes the children back into her womb, that is, back into the earth. So there's more creation to happen, but Uranus won't let it happen. Gaia is not happy with this. Cronus remains inside the womb. Gaia gives him a sickle. She forms a sickle. It's called adamantine. She basically makes silver. And she makes a sickle out of it and provides it to Cronus, one of her children, in the womb. And she says the next time that Uranus lies on top of her, that Cronus should take the sickle and castrate him, right? To cut off his genitals. Are you okay? Yes, cutting off his genitals from the womb, perhaps, reaching out, right? Should I go into more description? No. Okay. The severed testicles of Cronus are tossed into the sea, Pontos, tossed into the sea. And those testicles in the sea start churning because this is divinity in the sea, in the water. And it creates a kind of foam. And who knows who was born from the foam? Aphrodite. Her name means born of foam. Okay, but this was a murder. This was a castration. Aphrodite's born from the foam. Oh, I put it up there for you, didn't I? Gave you the answer. Other parts of Cronus fall in various places. And this is really interesting because this is like accidental generation. These parts are just falling randomly. And they generate the Cyclops. You know the Cyclops from the Odyssey, right? A group of beings with one eye whom Odysseus has to battle. There are these giants that are monsters, right? Each of these three brothers here, each of the brothers has 50 heads and 100 arms. And they're 100-handed, right? So they're 100-handed giants, and these will be the most powerful of the offspring. So what are you gonna do with that? You're gonna put them away, because we've gotta keep the monster down for a little while, right? Of course, the other point here is that these gods are monstrous, and these monsters are godlike. So from the beginning, there wasn't quite the separation we're used to now with gods and monsters. All right, the Furies are created here. Do you remember the Furies? Sometimes called the Erinyes. These are basically gods, goddesses of vengeance. And in fact, if you read Aeschylus, his three-part play, the Oresteia, it's a really interesting process where the Furies become domesticated and used actually in the service of justice. I don't want to go into the Oresteia with you, but it's basically, remember Medea? She's there, the one who kills her children, and starts off in this horrific scene. But Athena gets involved, and eventually justice prevails. Notice that the Furies are not destroyed. They're contained. Right? And we're going to see that theme over and over again, with monsters being put away because you need them. Remember, we talked last time, you got to have the monster. The monster's the other. All right, Uranus retreats, having been castrated, retreats and becomes the sky, and no longer touches the earth. Again, we have these etiological tales here that explain things. Why is the sky up in the heavens? Why is the earth here? Well, you see, there was Uranus and Gaia. All right. I'm actually giving you the short version of the Theogony. You may not believe that, but there's a lot going on here. Cronus now, okay, so second generation deity. There's Uranus and Gaia. They produce Cronus and his siblings. So second generation deity. Cronus marries his sister, Rhea, because what other choice do you have, right? And they produce Hestia, Demeter, Hera, Hades, Poseidon, Zeus. Oh, Zeus. Oh. Zeus is a third generation god. Yes. And Kronos decides that he is jealous of his children. He's perhaps heard something in the wind that one of his children may overthrow him as the king of the gods. And so he swallows each child as it is born. You see how this can get confusing? It's because the stories are replicating themselves. So Uranus forces the children to stay in Gaia. Now Kronos swallows each child as it's born. Rhea, the ever-tricky woman, right? And I mean that in a positive sense, because this is how women have to survive in the pantheon. She gives Zeus a rock covered in, I'm sorry, she gives Kronos a rock wrapped in swaddling clothes. So he thinks it's a child. He thinks it's Zeus. He swallows it because gods are apparently dumb about these things. Rhea places Zeus in protective custody. He's hidden in Crete because a mother takes care of her children as much as she can. Plus, there's a certain fate at work here, right? That's Goya's painting of Uranus eating his children. Uranus eating Kronos. Man, I cannot keep these straight. Sorry. Pretty famous painting. Well, what happens next? The Titanomachy, the battle of the Titans and the Olympians. The Titans are Kronos and his siblings. The Olympians are Zeus and his siblings. You probably know this story. A spell causes Kronos to spit out the children in reverse order, making Zeus both the youngest and the oldest child, by the way. Then there's a 10-year war between the Titans and the Olympians. Zeus wins and bounds the Titans in Tartarus. Ah, remember Tartarus? That pit at the very beginning? Oh, that's what that was for. It's also a symbolic womb, right? Or tomb, right? Which is both. The festival celebrating the defeat of the Titans becomes the Olympics, because these gods lived on Mount Olympus. All right. Now, lots more happens in the Theogony. This much happens, which I'm not going to subject you to. But you get to see, this is actually, despite it's a bit overwhelming at first, but if you look to the left, you see a circle with the Olympians. If you look to the right, the Titans. And then it kind of comes into being there. You can see the other gods and where they come from. I show you this only to show you how complex the genealogy gets. And of course, all these gods, remember, are anthropomorphic. They mean things. And so they're about forces in the world interacting. So what does this mean? Well, first of all, the first god is chaos, or emptiness. It's an interesting etymology there, because in literal Greek, the word just simply means emptiness. At first, it was emptiness. And yet, the word comes to mean disorder. Let's hold that and think about that. Come back to it. The more anthropomorphic, the more human-like the gods become, the greater civilization becomes, the less madness there is, right? The less unpredictability. Remember we talked about in religion and anthropomorphism, how to make a god. We do not like complexity. We need, I'm talking about just in terms of perceptual survival skills. We need things simple We don't need several different signals competing with each other. So the increased, the more the gods become like us, the more civilized we become. You can also turn that around, right? There is an obsession with succession and possession of the world. And eventually that becomes of women. I'm looking at you, Zeus. Then, what's striking to me still is patriarchy here. These are male gods. The female gods are there because they have to be, but then they quickly are either attacked or harmed or just received behind the noise of the patriarchy, of the male gods, arguing, fighting, destroying each other. So, the stories of the gods are the stories of us. It's a theogony. It's a myth told about the birth of the gods, but like all myths, it's about us. It's about us psychologically, and it's about us culturally. And there is one more story in the Theogony that is about that very thing. Notice we have no humans. No humans in the story yet. In fact, humans play a very minor role. But they do appear with a guy named Prometheus. Prometheus is one of the Titans. He's one of the sons of Cronus. By the way, Cronus is not, it is Kappa in Greek, not Chi. So it's not the time god. That would be CH, the Chi. But it actually does get blurred as Greek culture goes along, because it's so easy to slip those two together. Prometheus. It's here that we see humans for the first time. Prometheus means forethought. And he's trying to trick Zeus, because again, the Titans and the Olympians don't get along, with an offering at a place called Mekone. And basically what happens here is Zeus hides the fire from humans because he's been tricked by Prometheus. It's actually about the origins of sacrifice. So Prometheus, they're meeting to decide how we should worship them, the gods are. And so the question is, do the gods get the best meat, or do they get the bones? What should happen? Now Prometheus, always an advocate for us, and he's a Titan, which is interesting, always an advocate for us, says, well, you know, humans should get the best meat. And of course, the gods disagree because they're gods and they're jerks, and they want the best meat. So Prometheus, the trickster, which is something we should come back to, the notion of trickery, wraps up the bones with the fat. So it looks like the best meat is going to be inside this fat, but in fact, it's bones. Now, it gets really interesting here because the other stories of Prometheus have him genuinely tricking Zeus into saying, oh, I'll take this, and it's a bag full of bones. And if you know about Greek religion, you know that what's offered to the gods are the bones. You burn the bones, right? So, looks like Zeus was really tricked and instituted this practice, this ritual. But Hesiod is, he's a patron of Zeus. In fact, the whole Theogony is really about the primacy of Zeus. And so he puts it in there, and it's confused everybody for 3,000 years. And he says, well, Zeus knew this. He knew what was happening. And you're like, that makes no sense. But if you take away that little part, it does make sense. Zeus was genuinely tricked. And then if you see Hesiod as kind of his, shall we say, spokesperson, who twists the story. All right. So Zeus is pissed about this. He decides to keep fire from humans. All right, so what? Well, fire is a symbol, of course. It's also a very real thing that is required for civilization. If you don't have fire, you can't settle down. You got to keep moving. You're in constant danger. Fire is like the first product, the first essential for civilization, fire. Zeus says, I'm not going to give it to you because Prometheus, you tricked me. Prometheus steals it back. Love this guy, right? He hides it in a fennel stalk, and there's a great scene in the Theogony where Zeus comes down, and in the distance where the humans are, because humans are always in the distance, unless it's a beautiful woman for Zeus, they're always, he sees the fire. And Zeus says, hey, did you trick me again? Yes, Zeus, you were tricked again. And the punishment, you may know this, is that Prometheus is chained to a rock forever. And each day, an eagle, symbol of Zeus, comes and eats his liver. And it grows back every day, right? So Prometheus chained to this rock, Prometheus bound, right, is the way we know Prometheus. He's cut open, his liver's there, the eagle comes, gnaws on it all day, night falls, it all happens all over again. The Greeks were great with punishment, right? You remember Sisyphus, no doubt? There's a guy named Tantalus who is forever reaching for fruit that he can't get or water that he can't drink. Anyway, Zeus has another punishment in store for humans, and she is woman. Ah, sorry. Again, this is probably sounding familiar. We can talk about that. Her name is Pandora, and again, it's a little confusing in Hesiod's account, but Pandora, combination Greek word, pan is all, as you probably know. Dora is gift, a gift to all, or giving of all. Again, this is making a lot of sense for the nature of women in Greek culture and perhaps in world culture. She's actually sent to Prometheus's brother, Epimetheus. But again, as the story keeps rolling on, she seemed to be sent to men as a punishment from Zeus. So the punishment is woman. You may know she has a box that holds all the evils of the world and hope. And she opens the box, woman does, and, you know, this gift giver, irony maybe, this gift giver opens the box and all the evils of the world come out. But hope can't quite get out of the box. I know that story. I live that story every day, right? Where there's so much evil, and where's the hope? Oh, it's stuck under the lid of the box, right? What does this mean? The introduction of woman as evil, as the source of evil, not just evil herself, but she has all the evils and she looses them upon the world as a punishment to men. Well, we've been poring over this for about 3,000 years, and we don't really know, but maybe the point is not to know. Hope remains in the jar. Why? In the box, sorry. Or the jar. Why? First of all, if hope is a good thing, what's it doing in the box of evils to begin with? Maybe it's an evil to have hope. Is a bad thing because it raises your expectations when your expectations are going to be crushed under Zeus's will. There's no hope. I think of Lord of the Rings in the caves of Mordor where Ian McKellen.
Gandalf.
Thank you. God. I am just, I can't think of Gandalf. Gandalf disappears, right, in the caves. And they're like, well, we have no hope now. He was our hope. And I think it's Frodo who says, we must go on without
hope. The mines of Moria.
Mines, sorry, thank you. We must go on without hope. Yeah, actually, you must. There is, of course, the psychological interpretation. The jar or the box is the womb. Women are evil. Women are vehicles for evil because they produce these sons who are horrible and keep destroying each other and threaten to destroy the world. The word hope in Greek is elpis, and it actually doesn't quite mean hope as we think of it. It means expectation. So again, there's that sense of don't have expectations, which is actually a pretty advanced notion that you don't get until Epictetus, who's a Roman citizen, and the Stoics. So I don't know, just nobody can decide on what this means. But there is clearly evil in everyday life. Thank you, Pandora. And we continue to have hope. Maybe we shouldn't. Maybe our expectations are falsely grounded, but we continue to do that.
So are they making a monster out of women?
Yes.
Right.
Remember, when we talked about monsters and the other, it was them, but also she. She and them. Yeah. This notion of the monster as female goes all the way back to the Theogony. Yeah. I know, it's quite sobering, isn't it? This misogyny, how deeply it's buried, it's not buried, how deeply it goes. Very sobering. Beautiful words, though. You heard some of them. All right. I want to take you back and over to a different place now, to Mesopotamia, and another story of the birth of the gods that's going to sound similar. Different, but similar, of course. This is Enuma Elish, which is really just the first words of the cuneiform tablet, went on and on. So there weren't titles in the ancient world. They were just these stories. And so you start the story, went on high, so that becomes the title. That becomes what we call it. Discovered in 1849. Goes back to the 18th century BCE. That is old, right? And it's part of the seven tablets of creation. It is a ritual text. Meaning, and in fact, I think all these are probably ritual texts in one way or another. That is, they're performed, they're sung, because remember, there's no writing in the original forms of the stories, so you sing them. And usually you do that in a ritual setting. All right. Here is the opening, the passage of Enuma Elish. When on high the heaven had not been named, firm ground below had not been called by name, when primordial Apsu there begathered, and Mumu Tiamat, she who bore them all, their waters mingled as a single body. No reed hut had sprung forth, no marshland had appeared. None of the gods had been brought into being, and none bore a name. And no destinies determined. Then it was that the gods were formed in the midst of heaven. Lamu and Lahamu were brought forth by name. Okay, same thing is going on here. These names, proper names, are also entities or forces. Apsu is male. His name means begetter. sweet waters. So Apsu is fresh water. Tiamat is female, the female goddess, and her name means bitter or salt water, the fresh and salt water. Not accidental that Mesopotamia is framed by the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, which empty into the Persian Gulf, the fresh water and the salt water. This maker figure, Mumu Tiamat, this is debated, but seems to be the equivalent of Eros or lust in the Theogony. It's that force. It may even mean mold. So this is how you make things, this is how we shape things, but we're not the thing, we're the mold for the thing. Lamu and Lahamu, Lahamu means slime and mud. So again, we like this story of coming from mud. Anshar, we have the whole sky. Kishar, the whole earth. This goes on and on. That I didn't show you here. Anshar and Kishar give birth to Anu, a sky god, Uranus. And he begets his likeness, that's the phrase, Ea, a trickster god of the flowing waters. Uh-oh. You see trouble brewing here? Of course you do. There is, again, a rejection of the original creation. This is fascinating to me. Why would we do this? Why would we tell a story like this, where the original creation is rejected by a second generation of gods? But here it is. Thus, again, from the Enuma Elish, thus were established and were the great gods. This is after, I'm skipping a lot, right? There were those other gods created. They disturbed Tiamat as she surged back and forth, right? Tiamat, the ocean. Yes, they troubled the mood of Tiamat by their hilarity in the abode of heaven, laughing gods. Apsu, this is the freshwater, her husband, could not lessen their clamor. She's got noisy kids, right? And the father figure says, and I mean, they're both really frustrated, but the father figure, Apsu, says, their ways are evil. So they just can't take it anymore. And Apsu cries out and says to Tiamat, we must destroy our children. We must destroy our children. Because they're too loud, and I don't understand them, right? Tiamat, angry as she is, surging as she is, she's the ocean, decides, no, I can't do that. They're annoying as hell, these kids, but I can't wipe them out. Apsu, the father, says, I can, no problem. And so he gets with Mumu, that shaper mold god, gets with Mumu and decides that they're going to kill the children. Ea is one of his children, and he overhears this plot, and he says, not going to happen. This sounds familiar, Cronus plotting against Uranus. I'm just looking at my notes here. There's an interesting scholarly interpretation that the activity of the children is actually this new sense of energy in the cosmos, which I think is a kind of interesting interpretation, that the children are the energy. You can't control the energy, right? And so you want to stop the energy. And Tiamat will not have it. In fact, the phrase there is to abolish their ways, the children's ways, but not just to shut them up, but to abolish their ways of being in the world. of being gods. Alright, so again, the rebellion of the second generation of gods. Now, there's no indication that these two stories had any commerce with each other. Enuma Elish is thousands of years earlier than the Theogony. They're in different places, and yet, in the collective unconscious, we want to tell this story this way. Very interesting. So, again, what happens is Ea steals Apsu's insignia and other items, these notions of these signs of divinity and kingship, because it's kind of the same thing at this point. Ea holds Apsu down and kills him, and it's brutal. He puts a nose ring in his nose, like an ox, and leads him around and slaughters him. Ea has a child named Marduk, whose name means son of the sun. And he's a monster. He has four large eyes and ears, fire blazes from his mouth, and he has four winds that he's given to play with. Oh God, what a terrible idea. Give a child the four winds to play with. This again annoys the other god. So, now Tiamat's like, screw it, kill them all. I'm sick of all of them. Remember, Apsu's gone. He's already been murdered by Ea. Now, Ea's son is even worse. And she's like, I've had it. Let's just get rid of them. I am going to fight you, Marduk, and you're going to lose. And she's pretty amazing. She's the ocean. She has a lot of energy. She has a lot of power. And she generates more monsters to fight Marduk. She gets another husband, King Gu. The gods are now upset, and they realize that Marduk is their only hope, and he's pretty sly, and he's like, well, I will fight Tiamat, but only if you agree to make me king. Now remember, this is a ritual text. And the ritual is to show and to celebrate the high kingship, the highest deity that is Marduk. All right, so of course we know how the story is going to end with Marduk victorious. He gathers his own weapons, defeats Tiamat and the gods who have aligned with Tiamat. And what he does is do I have the passage here? He remember those winds he was playing with? He uses them to blow into Tiamat's mouth and puff her up, and then he throws a spear into her. This is like 18th century BC. This is 4,000 years ago. This is happening. Here's the text. He sliced her in half like a fish for drying. Half of her he put up to the roof, the sky. He drew a bolt across it and made a guard to hold it. Her waters he arranged so they could not escape. Then he takes Kingu, remember the husband she got? Marduk does. And he says, blood I will mass. It's getting really gross, isn't it? Blood I will mass and cause bones to be. I will establish a savage. Man shall be his name. Savage man I will create, and he shall be charged with the service of the gods, that they, the gods, might be at ease. Because the gods were pissed off they were having to do so much after the battle, after Marduk won. Oh, well, you're in charge of the universe now, dude. So get to maintaining the universe. And I go, well, this sucks. We don't want to do that. Let's make humans do it. And here we are. So, this is Tiamat and Apsu. And this is how Mesopotamians saw the world. Think of it like a kind of an egg in water, right? So there's water all around Tiamat, right? And we live inside this bubble. So there are waters above the firmament, if that phrase sounds familiar. There's the abyss, but it's water all around. But then there's water, fresh water, Epsu, right? And what I didn't tell you, because I'm trying to save time, and trying not to inflict too much on you, is that when Ea kills Absu, he builds a house on his body. He builds a house on the fresh water. Oh, we know that's right here, that's Earth, right? Notice there are floodgates on the sky, on the dome, and the gods can open those when they feel like torturing us, which is sometimes. All right, there's also this Sheol place, this kind of pit place that comes over into Judaism as Sheol, and it's a place where the dead go, Tartarus, right? Very similar. All right, now what does all this mean? This is the same slide from the Theogony. What does all this mean? Patriarchy and its anxieties. Succession, possession. Increased anthropomorphism means more civilization, means more order, less chaos. Now, one final thing before we start the discussion. I kind of hinted that chaos really just means emptiness. And yet it gets, in the process of the world coming into being, it gets treated as disorder. There's a reading of chaos that is simply feminine. It's the feminine. So you can see all this activity and all this creation of gods and monsters as a reaction, again, to the feminine. So why would that be? Because the stories we have, like the Theogony and Enuma Elish, the stories we have are the ones that are written. There were other oral stories. There were stories that were just told and were not written down and existed that way. We talked about this in regard to the New Testament in our last session. So what that means is, you don't get this story, you don't get this version until somebody can write it. And that somebody is going to be a man. You see this over and over again. With writing comes patriarchy. Before writing, we don't know. It's like looking at the edge of the universe, but the archaeological evidence says that that blank space, it's probably feminine. And if you want to read more about this, check out Brianne Eisler's The Chalice and the Blade. She talks about the emergence of writing and civilization and patriarchy all at the same time. All right, I'm going to stop there. It's 8 o'clock. Thank you for your patience. I know this is kind of slow going, but happy to talk to you about it. Margot, I know you got a question.
I don't know if the question as much as, writing, male,
right.
Non-verbal or non-language would be considered feminism?
Spoken.
Spoken. Okay, what about music? Where does music go?
Oh, great question. Music would be, it's part of every culture, but it's intimately involved in communication in an oral culture, because in an oral culture, to remember a story, you have to put it in a structure that's memorable, and that's going to be music, or it's going to be some other things, but largely it's going to be musical. And so the original poets were singers, and they sung these stories. So music is absolute, it's like air for an oral culture. I know that's a lot I kind of just laid on you at the very end there, so take some time to process it. Yeah, John.
So, male, female, like, the ancients considered intellect male, like you say, writing, letters.
Yes.
Men of great letters. And then they considered art, beauty, feelings, compassion, love.
The muses, yep.
Female.
Yep.
So everywhere we see a female character or a male character, we have to stop and think, wait, are we talking about, you know, one of these abstract concepts? Are we talking about, are we talking about ourselves? Is
right.
Is the text actually speaking directly to the person who happens to be reading that text at the moment? Is it saying this part of yourself,
right,
the intellect, is going to do battle with,
right,
you know?
Right.
And in each and every case.
That's an excellent point. We've made that work. But by not obliterating the feminine, but by giving it a creative aspect, as you said. Indeed, the muses are what inspire the writers and the singers. That's what we've done. It's not what we had to do. We could have done other things, but that's what we've done. Satinder.
Just been thinking through all of this. I mean, you've got succession and possession there. So I'm hearing authority and primacy, right?
Kingship, yeah.
But then we have these two myths that are about 2,000 years apart, different parts of the world, effectively identical, right?
Yeah, amazing.
Different generations. And it's always the men fighting against the men, pushing away the women.
Right.
These stories are written by men.
Yes.
So.
Written down by men.
Yeah, written down by men. Right.
Yeah.
So, my question is, what's the psychology driving that, and why is it 2,000 years apart, still the same?
Excellent question. The question was, what's the psychology driving this? And one answer, again, is Rhianne Eisler and other feminist archaeologists and psychologists, and it's something called womb envy, which plays nicely against penis envy, right? But I think this is a much more valid approach than penis envy. Because penis envy is about Freud and that, all that stuff. Womb envy is, I think, pretty evident here to me, is that the problem is that these females can create life and we can't. And they must be controlled. Or they'll just keep creating life and they'll become powerful. And they'll have all these children who have allegiances to them. And where am I going to be when I want to be a king, or king of the gods? What about my needs?
So, well, secession.
Yeah.
So why a son that knows his own father? That's a big part of the control.
Knows that his own father will kill him.
Well, I just mean that you know who your mother is, but you don't know who your
father is. Right. Sorry, I went way too far.
Yeah, way, yeah. I was biology.
Yeah, right. Thank you. Did you want to follow up?
Yeah, okay. So that's the womb. That's the female part of the question.
Right.
But then these men all want to beat the other men, and then so they all want to kill their father.
Yeah.
That's what.
And the fathers want to kill
the fathers.
Sons.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because there's God. They're gods. They're not going to die.
What's that?
They're gods, they won't die, so there's no succession unless you take it.
They're not going to die a natural death, you're saying?
Right.
Yeah.
What a character.
Yeah.
Sounds like bad parenting.
But remember the first god, this god, is chaos. We're born into chaos.
Yeah, so what's the anxiety there? Like the unknown, just like not being able to like...
The womb anxiety?
Yeah, or just so chaos is like emptiness, right?
That's the etymological meaning, but it comes to mean disorder. Mm-hmm. And it becomes a kind of or monster, right? Because monsters represent that chaos.
So, I don't know, so I'm just like wondering, I'm just thinking, I think a lot about, yeah, feminine and masculine, and we can all be, we're all both, we can be whatever we want, right, like mentally, or like, we don't subscribe to being, we have, I have a both, so I guess, right?
No, you don't get to, culture doesn't let you do that.
Yeah.
Not without great strife.
Yeah, yeah, but I'm just wondering where the, like, the need to possess something comes from. Is that just the, like, ego or something? Or something?
Right, that's where I'm getting to. Like,
biology.
Okay, there it is.
You're Aquarius, everybody.
Somebody had to say it. It's biology. It's biological determinism that men must possess. Or did you mean men and women, Joe? Well said. By saying nothing.
Like this.
Okay. Well, the story we know is that men are biologically determined. When I say we know, I mean it's the story that's been told. Biologically determined to possess, to kill. It's in our wiring. It's in our DNA.
But
yes.
But it's not just humans. You
right.
Know what I mean?
Good
that's,
point.
That's, again, biologically speaking, there's a drive, there's, you know, pass on your genes, the weaker go, the stronger survive.
Yeah.
And so, you know, as cultures become more sophisticated, they just need to explain that.
They need to explain what?
That need to...
That we have it?
That we have... Well, they're observing it in nature, they're observing it in their own culture, that there are strong males that are suppressing the weaker males and possessing the women. And
do you think they knew, do you think Hesiod knew that he was talking about patriarchy and he was talking about alpha males?
I think Hesiod is so far past where the initial sort of rudimentary explanations of behavior are had. He has a sophisticated view. And that there are rudimentary basis for Hesiod's positions that you know,
that he's mythologizing.
Exactly. That there are cultural explanations for biological behavior.
Yeah.
Why are we acting this way? Well, it's because
you can go right from there to a little book by Sigmund Freud called Civilization and Its Discontents. If you want it, you can go other places too.
That is what?
You could go other places besides Freud. You're welcome to.
Yeah, but what did you say is the civilizations at its discontent?
Sigmund Freud's book, Civilization and Its Discontents, is basically that we create gods in order to become father figures for us to control our shit, right? Because otherwise we won't on our own.
Well,
so it's cultural explanation for about that's Freud, right? I know, you can't get away from it. Yeah.
Isn't it all old news? Like, can't, like, what about right now?
What about right now? Can we escape this story?
Yeah, I mean, is there a pill that guys can take to stop being jackasses or something like that? Or is there some sort of, like, way to, I don't know, it's like now the age of the internet and access to unlimited information and stuff, like, I don't feel like this is all kind of old news. And
okay, this is a good point, but don't you think what's going on in the world, but it's actually becoming more, it's exacerbated right now?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it comes in waves. I
yeah,
think
sure.
that people's
yeah.
understanding and awareness comes in waves.
Yeah.
So do you think, okay, so following on from that, is it realistic to say that men are just men and always been men, always will be men, but there are times when it sort of, it peaks and troughs?
Well, what I'm getting from this is that chaos. We're all born into chaos and emptiness and disorder and not knowing what we're supposed to do. But women have the ability to create life, and so that makes men kind of have this fervent anger and need to know and understand themselves and their part in the world, which creates this violence